They thought it would be over
by Christmas.
They did.
A lot of them had no idea even why they were fighting. Hundreds of thousands of Germans had been living in England, working as cab drivers and as waiters, construction workers, had to leave their jobs and their homes. To go back to Germany to fight against the people that they had driven around and lived next door to. If you paid attention, you wouldn't have been surprised by the truce. There had been talk of a truce. Pope Benedict XV contacted involved for a ceasefire over the holidays. He was rebuffed. 101 British suffragettes wrote a letter, an open letter to the women of Austria and Germany, proposing a ceasefire for the holidays. 100 years ago last night, a chocolate cake arrived at a British trench, sent over by the Germans, with an invitation to a concert that they wanted to hold in honor of their captain who was celebrating his birthday. They said, "Leave your guns, your only admission is your empty hands." No more than Rosa Parks sitting down on that bus on December 1st, 1955 was a spontaneous act. Neither was the truce. The path was laid for it all along. And it happened for many different reasons. Most people think of it as sort of a battle of Christmas carols. But it happened for lots of different reasons. The London Daily Mail, January 1st, 1915, the first reporting of the truce, reports that a chaplain was sent to the British side into the trenches for a funeral of a Scottish officer. And some of the men attending the funeral noticed that the Germans were standing around their trenches, unarmed. A few minutes later, shovels started to rain out from those German trenches into the field where hundreds of British and German dead lay. The English, the British, answered with dozens of shovels thrown out from their trench. And a ceasefire was called for people to bury their dead, after which there was a joint prayer service over the graves. In Denmark in 1988, I was playing a festival in a little town called Turnder on the German border. It's a town of about 10,000 people that swells to about 50,000 people for one weekend in August every year. They have musicians from all over the world, and I was lucky enough to be one of the musicians from the United States. And you'd play four or five different places, in a circus marquee on the town square, in a union hall, in a church sanctuary, in a school auditorium, in an old mill. And no matter where I played, about 5 minutes into the show, the back door or the tent flap would open, and in would walk, where the only person who could see the back of the tent was the guy on stage, were four, what I could tell by their silhouettes, were very old men. And by this time, there wasn't a chair to be had, and so they made their way up to the front, right in front of the stage, and took their place among the big crowd of teenagers that had gathered there. And they watched the show without expression, which is pretty much how the teenagers were watching it too. At the end of each show, they would catch my eye and nod and turn and leave. Well, finally, it's my last show. I just finished the last song, and I looked down, and certainly, sure enough, there they were. They nodded, just like always, and turned and started to make their way out. And all I could think of was, who are these guys? And forgetting everything I've ever learned about stage etiquette, I leapt off the front of the stage, much to the delight of the teenagers, I might add. And I made my way up the center aisle, and I caught the last guy just before he went out the back door, and I said, who are you and why are you here? And luckily, he spoke English. And he turned around and he said, well, we've come to see you. Can't you tell? We've been at all your shows. I said, yes, but why? And by this time, his three comrades had gathered around. And they told me their story. These were four old men in their late 80s at this point who had grown up in the same neighborhood in the same little town about 100 kilometers from Berlin. They were best friends. They went to the same schools, played on the same soccer teams, and when the Kaiser's army called in 1914, they all went down and, like Mr. Buckles, lied about their age and joined the Kaiser's army. And they were so scared. They were just boys, 14 years old. Somehow they all made it back home. They got married, moved far away from one another, had kids, got jobs, retired. Their wives passed away, and they found themselves four old men living by themselves. They wrote to one another and decided that they were all going to move in together. And at that point, they had four adjoining rooms in the big veterans' home in Berlin. And they said, it's pretty good. I mean, they treat us well there. The hard part is you don't get to see very many young people. Oh, the orderlies and the nurses and so on, they're young, but you can tell that they think we're crazy because we try to tell them our stories. Well, one day, one of us was listening to the radio and we heard one of our stories, our most important story coming out of the radio. And we gathered all the interns and the orderlies around and made them listen to it, because we thought maybe if one of our stories was told by a young voice, they would believe us. Because we had to prove to them that we weren't crazy, because we were there. We were there. And these four old men, back when they were four scared young teenagers, for one night were perhaps the sanest people on the planet. Oh, my name is Francis Tolliver. I come from Liverpool. 2 years ago, the war was waiting for me after school. Belgium and to Flanders, to Germany to here, I fought for king and country I love dear. It was Christmas in the trenches, where the frost so bitter hung. The frozen fields of France were still, no Christmas songs were sung. Our families back in England were toasting us then. Day, they're brave and glorious lads so far away. Well, I was lying with my messmates on the cold and rocky ground when across the lines of battle came a most peculiar sound. Says I, now listen up, boys, each soldier strained to hear as one young German voice sang out so clear. He's singing bloody well, you know, my partner says to me. Soon one by one each German voice joined in harmony. The cannons rested silent, the gas clouds rolled no more as Christmas brought us respite from the war. Well, as soon as they were finished and a reverent pause was spent, God rest ye merry gentlemen, struck up some lads from Kent. The next they sang was Stille Nacht, 'tis Silent Night, says I, and in two tongues one song filled up that sky. There's someone coming towards us, the frontline sentry cried. All sights were fixed on one lone figure trudging from their side. His truce flag like a Christmas star shone on that plain so bright as he bravely strode unarmed into the night. Soon one by one on either side walked into no man's land. With neither gun nor bayonet, we met there hand to hand. We shared some secret brandy, and we wished each other well. And in a flare-lit soccer game, we gave them hell. Traded chocolates, cigarettes, and photographs from home. These sons and fathers far away from families of their own. Young Sanders played his squeeze box. They had a violin. This curious and unlikely band of men. Upon us, and France was France once more. With sad farewells, we each began to settle back to war. But the question haunted every heart that beat that wondrous night: whose family have I fixed within my sights? It's Christmas in the trenches where the frost so bitter hung. The frozen fields of France were warmed as songs of peace were sung. The walls they'd kept between us to exact the work of war had been crumbled, gone forevermore. Oh, my name is Francis Tolliver, in Liverpool I dwell. Each Christmas comes since World War I, learned its lessons well. That the ones who call the shots won't be among the dead and lame, and on each end of the rifle we're the same.